So, first of all, let me thank the organizers for the opportunity to be here and to talk to this audience. The goal of my talk is to introduce a network model with random geometry, with geometric disorder that describes the plateau transition in the integer quantum Hall transition. So, to do this, I will first briefly remind you of the Chalker-Coddington network, and then I will introduce random geometric disorder and tell you how to use the quantum transfer matrix approach to evaluate the correlation length exponent. So first of all, let's briefly start with the quantum Hall effect. So we probably all know it. We have a conductor in the presence of a magnetic field, and perpendicular to the magnetic field, the Hall conductance arises. And if we go to low temperatures in a regime, in the regime of the Fermi energy, the Hall conductance evolves and plateaus. And each time we hit a Landau level, there's a transition to the next plateau. And the reason for the plateaus is localization of states. Now, Chalker and Coddington in the late 80s introduced a network model to examine this transition. And well, it is a quasi-classical model where they consider an electron moving in a random potential landscape, and it's traveling there in hills and around hills and valleys, and in those valleys we have the Fermi sea that restricts the electron from going deeper. So where is the light? It is there. When two valleys are close to each other, tunneling might appear, and the electron swaps from one to the other. So I think I already told you about this. Coming once back to the electron moving in the potential, now we want to formalize it to come to the network model. Having a saddle point here, a transition might appear, and this one in the network model is described by a vertex with a reflection coefficient for the case the electron stays on the same side, and a transition for its moving to the other side. This way we have two different vertices. Well, we'll come to this. This network model has extensively been studied in the past, and it establishes that the correlation length exponent is around 2.6. The early authors had to struggle with lack of computational power in those days. Now, agreement is better, and well, the poor thing is it does not really coincide with the experimental value, so there's still something to be understood. We introduce a new idea which has not yet been studied, namely random geometry in the network. This again is the picture with the electron traveling in the potential field. Well, on the last slide, it naturally comes to some square lattice, but in reality, here we have three vertices, and these, by purpose, have a known number of vertices. Going to the right side, this does not translate to a square lattice, but we have any kind of polygons. So now, how to construct such a network? We get started with the Chalker-Coddington network to do this, and then construct the random lattice from this one. How does it work? Imagine we have two of these yellow puddles here, and we enforce now transmission. Means the electron does not has no choice but needs to go here. So let me draw this again. Then we are here, going to the next one, and now we have a form with six vertices. This way, with the next one, we of course always can have more. Now imagine in this point, well, here it goes on, imagine in this point we enforce a reflection. Then this edge is not really there anymore, and we are left with five vertices. And this way, we can just establish any polygon. Now, how to translate this to formulas? In the S matrix picture, we can describe every vertex with a 2x2 matrix, and it just describes the possibility for reflection or for transmission in this vertex. We have two types of such vertices, with the incoming states in these edges or in these edges respectively. And of course there's the condition of for R square plus T square equals 1 in order to preserve the particles. Now, how to introduce the randomness again? Well, with the probability P1, we enforce a reflection, and with the probability P2, we enforce transmission in one vertex, and well, with what's left, there is an ordinary node where both might happen. In our work now, we just consider equal probabilities P1 and P2, which we define to be P. Now, just a brief comment on why do I call it geometric disorder? This is because the geometry, the polygons may be connected to curvature by the discrete Gauss theorem. I will not go deeper into this talk, but this is why we can call it geometric. Now, with the S matrix picture, we heard to talk about it. It is necessary to sum up all possible paths, and a way to do this in a very convenient way is to go to the column transfer matrix picture, where this kind of happens automatically. this is based on a reformulation of the nodes, which before were described by two matrix with the incoming states coming in diagonal. We reformulate it now in a way for a transmission from the incoming states on the left, outgoing on the right. This way, we have a big matrix with all those type of block matrices on the diagonal, and by multiplying with this big matrix, we are transmitting from, we are going from one column from the left to the right. We had two types of vertices being in one row above each other, so this corresponds to having two of these column transfer matrices. Well, this way it is quite easy to establish a transfer matrix for the whole lattice, but we pick a problem with introducing our randomness. We were talking about setting R or T respectively to zero, and this one, this picture, of course, is a singularity. Therefore, we have to solve this by an approximation. Means we cannot put T to zero, but to some small value. And if T is put to some small value epsilon, R has to be treated correspondingly. Now, the problem is if we choose epsilon not small enough, the approximation is bad. If we choose it too big, then the equations are numerically ill-conditioned, and we expect that at a certain point the result gets worse again. Well, at this point I'm jumping a bit ahead of my talk, because I'm talking about values which are not yet introduced. But what we need to do is do test calculations in order to find a proper regime for epsilon, for this approximation, and well, also to see whether approximation is possible at all. And well, X is some parametrization for the reflection and the transmission coefficient. M is the number of vertices in the lattice. So let's say it's the height of the lattice. And L is the width of the lattice, in this case 1,000,000. And we are calculating the Lyapunov exponent, which I will be introducing in the next slide, for different values of epsilon. And now we can compare them. And we see that within this regime, there's fairly little, there's just a very little change in the exponents when changing the value of epsilon. As expected for the largest one, the change starts to be bigger again. And this is why we choose to be somewhere to the right edge of this plateau where the the result does not change much. Now, I have been talking about Lyapunov exponents, how to go there, and what is all this? Well, first we want to establish a transfer matrix for the whole lattice. And as before I mentioned, the column transfer matrix A and B, just multiplying with them, lets you transmit one column to the right. Now remember, we are on a model where electrons are traveling on a random potential, and while going around such a Fermi sea, such a puddle, they are the states are catching some phase, and these phases are respected with the diagonal matrix, where they are all put on the diagonal. So this is how this transfer matrix for the whole lattice arises. And then we have the Lyapunov exponent. Well, they are closely connected to the eigenvectors of eigenvalues of these matrix product. And for we are indeed interested in the smallest eigenvalue of this matrix product, which after taking the logarithm is the smallest positive one. We are interested in the smallest one because this is the slowest variation and therefore connected with the correlation length. So now further we are following the ideas of McKinnon and Kramer. When we are introducing a parametrization, convenient parametrization for the transmission and the reflection. This x vertically is the distance from the critical point. The critical point is reached for the Chertenkov network for x equals zero. Now, having the Lyapunov exponent, some finite size scaling analysis can be done. The left-hand side is known from the numerical simulations. The right-hand side is a scaling function. Here we have the correlation length index connected to the relevant field. And here we have the leading irrelevant field. The right-hand side is expanded first in the fields, and then the fields in X and M. And the expansion coefficients are used for fitting. Now we have, this is following the very inspiring papers by Slivin and Ozuki. Well, for our parameter p equals 1/3, this is the result. These are the curves with with different Lyapunov exponents. On the x-axis we have the value x, and the Lyapunov exponent on the y-axis, and for different m's we get certain lines, and as expected the minimums or the critical values all in the same place. Well, this is known for the Chertenkov-Coddington model. Doing the scaling analysis, the results are like this, and of course what we are happy about is to see that actually the critical exponent is fairly close to what was measured in experiment. So, but it's just the choice for one special parameter. For one, it's just a specific choice for our parameter. And the question now is, why is p equals 1/3 special? Well, this is the exponent in dependence of the parameter p, and we see what makes it special is that it's p equals 1/3 is the minimum of this curve. If we now look at the other parameters of, well, special interest maybe, in dependence on P, we unfortunately do not have one third as a special case. There the peak is a bit before. The same is for the constant coefficient of the expansion of the scaling function, which is here. Now another question which has to be addressed is the Harris criterion. The Harris criterion deals with the question whether by when introducing this order the critical transition stays the same or not. So the basic idea is we intersect the system into different patches, correlated patches, and now each of these patches has its own critical exponent. its own critical point. Now we are looking at how these critical points vary next to each other. The idea when it was introduced was looking at some spin model and spins on a timed binding model. And well, if in all those patches, when approaching the critical temperature, the critical point, the variation of the critical points stays smaller than the temperature approaching it. So, no. Then the transition will be ordered and nothing happens. So the variation is always small enough to approach the critical point in an ordered way. That means the nearer I'm coming, the smaller the fluctuations between those patches are, and the transition stays ordered. And for the case in with spins, you can estimate the fluctuations of the critical points with help of the central limit theorem, and then you're coming to the conclusion that the variation of the critical points somehow varies like the correlation lengths to the power of minus d half, d being the dimension of the system. And from the critical behavior, we know that this side behaves like the correlation length to the minus 1 over nu. And if we now plug this both in here, we end up with the Harris criterion. And if this one is fulfilled, the transition will be preserved, so there is no change of universality class. Everything stays like it is. Now, with our critical exponent nu being 2 point something, well, sorry, being 2 point something, it seems like we have a problem. Like it cannot be that the on universality classes means the exponent changes. So before I'm telling you why I think not all the assumptions for the Harris criterion are fulfilled, let me briefly show you the Kagome lattice. This is a lattice where we also examined and Chirac Coddington type lattice on without random geometry. Well, it is. All right. So, why I am telling you about this is because everyone would say, "Ah, what are you doing? Don't you remember the Harris criterion? What you're saying is not possible." So I want to say why I think the Harris criterion. The Harris criterion. The if. Yes. Well. So the Harris criterion is fulfilled. This means that the critical index should not change. But this is what we are claiming. So, and I want to talk about this contradiction. Because the Harris criterion is fulfilled. We have been introducing. So, and just have a. This is the Kagome lattice, and it is some special realization of the random network model. So now imagine, well, remember this picture. We have one patch that realizes the Kagome lattice, and another one might reflect any rotation or translation of the Kagome lattice. And there is a special one which maps the Kagome lattice onto itself, where just R and T are reversed. And we have analyzed the Kagome lattice, and there found that the critical reflection would be at 2.6, and for the rotated and shifted one, we therefore also know it, which would be 0.8. And for the random model in total, for x equals 0, we have R critical about 0.7. And now, in contrast to what we had in the spin case with temperature, now these different and these kind of fluctuations are not going away. So, when approaching the critical temperature, or let's say in our case, the critical reflection rate. So, in our case, probably the condition that the fluctuations are going are becoming small enough is not fulfilled. So we expect that the fluctuation of the different patches will be a rather broad distribution, and therefore we think the assumptions for the Harris criterion are not fulfilled in this case with the random geometry, and therefore it is not the problem that we fulfill the Harris criterion, but still can change the index. Some further comments on what we did, maybe on the numerics. We have been using the LU decomposition instead of the QR composition. This was quite beneficial, because it's at least twice as fast, sometimes more depending on the implementation. We have also been looking at different scaling functions, for example, two leading irrelevant fields, and we have been looking at logarithmic corrections instead of power law corrections, but unfortunately we could not really distinguish between the different models. Well, all of those fits kind of worked, and they were so close that we couldn't tell the difference. So now we are coming close to the end, and the summary is we have introduced a network with geometric disorder that is dependent on one parameter, and what definitely needs to be done is to understand the physical meaning of this parameter, the probability for sending P or T to an ordinary or to an enforced transmission or reflection. And what also needs to be remarked, it appears, because the index changes, that we are changing the universality class by tuning this parameter. And we can sum it up somehow in a phase diagram. Here we have the probability for the transmission to be put to 1, and here we have the probability P2 for the reflection to be 1. And we've been looking along these lines where P1 and P2 are identical, and in the point 0 we have the Chalker-Coddington model. And on this side we have a completely singular model where there's no vertex where tunneling or reflection might happen. It's all decided there in this point. Well, and in between there is a line which Ara told me he is convinced is a line of critical points that divides two massive phases. So questions on that last one, please go to Ara, and the other, well, otherwise, thanks for listening, and for the other questions, I'm waiting for you.